Random House Audio presents The Gone Away World by Nick Harkaway. Read for you by Kirby Heyborne. The dreamers of the day are dangerous men, for they may act their dream with open eyes to make it possible. This I did. T. E. Lawrence. Chapter 1. When it all began, pigs and crisis. Close encounters with management. The lights went out in the nameless bar just after 9. I was bent over the pool table with one hand in the bald patch behind the D, which Flynn the barman claimed was beer, but which was the same size and shape as Mrs. Flynn the barman's arse, nigh on a yard in the beam and formed like the cross-section of a cooking apple. The fluorescent over the table blinked out, then came back, and the glass-fronted fridge gave a low, lurching hum. The wiring buzzed, and then it was dark. A faint sheen of static danced on the TV on its shelf, and the green exit lamp sputtered by the door. I dropped my weight into the imprint of Mrs. Flynn the barman's hands and played the shot anyway. The white ball whispered across the felt, came off 2 cushions, and clipped the 8 cleanly into a side pocket. Doff, doff. Glonk. It was perfect. On the other hand, I'd been aiming for the 6. I'd given the game to Jim Hepzibah, and any time now when the power came back and everything was normal in the nameless bar, I'd pass the cue to my hero pal Gonzo, and Jim would beat him too. Any time now. Except that the lights stayed out, and the hollow glimmer of the TV set faded away. There was a small, quiet moment, the kind you just have time to notice, which makes you feel sad for no good reason. Then Flynn went out back, swearing like Billy-O, and if your man Billy-O ever met Flynn, if ever there was a cuss-off, a high noon kind of a thing with foul language, I know where my money'd be. Flynn hooked up the generator, which, God help us, was pig-powered. There was the sound of 4 large, foul-smelling desert swine being yoked to a capstan, a noise pretty much like a minor cavalry war, and then Flynn let loose some of his most abominable profanity at the nearest porker. It looked as if it wanted to vomit and bolted. The others, perforce, followed it in a slow but steady progression about the capstan, and then pig number 1 came back around, saw Flynn ready with another dose, and tried to stop. Lashed to the crosspiece and bundled along by its 3 fellows, it found it couldn't. So it gathered its flab-covered self and charged past him at piggy-top speed, and the whole cycle accelerated until, with a malodorous oinking crunch, the generator kicked in and the television lit up with the bad news. Or rather, it didn't light up. The picture was so dim that it seemed the set was broken. Then there were fireworks and cries of alarm and fear, very quiet but getting louder, and we realized Sally Culpepper was just now turning on the sound. The image shook and veered, and urgent men went past shouting, "Get back! Get clear!" and "Oh shit, look at that fucker Jesus!" which they didn't even bother to bleep. In the middle distance, it looked as if maybe a figure was rolling on the ground. Something had gone absolutely horribly awry in the world, and naturally, some asshole was present with a camera making himself 10k an hour hazard pay when he could have been rolling up his asshole sleeves and saving a life or two. I knew a guy in the go-away war who did just that, dumped the network's prize Digi-7 in a latrine trench and hauled 6 civilians and a sergeant from a burning medical truck, got the Queen's honor back home and a P-45 from his boss. He's in an institution now. Is Micah Monroe, and every day 2 guys from the Veterans Hospital come by and take him for a walk and make sure the medal's polished on its little stand by his bed. They're sweet old geezers, Harry and Hoyle, and they've got medals of their own, and they figure it's the least they can do for a man who lost his mind giving a damn. Harry's kid was in the medical truck, you see, one of the ones Micah couldn't reach. We stared at the screen and tried to make sense of what was on it. It looked, for a moment, as if the Jorgmund Pipe was on fire. But that was like saying the sky was falling. The pipe was the most solidly constructed, triple-redundant, safety-first, one-of-a-kind necessary object in the world. We built it fast and dirty because there was no other way. And then after that, we made it indestructible. The plans were drawn up by the best, then checked and rechecked by the very best, and then the checkers themselves were scrutinized, analyzed, and vetted for any sign of fifth columnism or martyr tendencies, or even a serious and hitherto undetected case of just plain stupid. And then the contractors went to work under a scheme which emphasized thoroughness and adherence to spec over swift completion, and which imposed penalties so dire upon speculators and profiteers that it would actually be safer just to throw yourself from a high place. And finally, the quantity surveyors and catastrophe experts went to town on it with hammers and saws, lightning generators and torsion engines, and declared it sound. Everyone in the Livable Zone was united in the desire to maintain and safeguard it. There was absolutely no chance that it could imaginably, conceivably, possibly be on fire. It was on fire in a big way. The pipe was burning painful white, magnesium, corpse belly, nauseating white, and beside it there were buildings and fences, which meant this wasn't just the pipe, but something even more important, a pumping station or a refinery. The whole place was wrapped in hot, shining smoke, and deep in the heart of the furnace there was stuff going on the human eye didn't know what to do with. Weird, bad news stuff which came with its own ominous soundtrack. On the screen, something very important crumbled into noise and light. "Fuck," said Gonzo William Lubitsch, speaking for everyone. It was a funny feeling. We were looking at the end of the world, again, and we were looking at something awful we'd never wanted to see. But at the same time, we were looking at fame and fortune and just about everything we could ever ask for delivered by a grateful populace. We were looking at our reason for being, because that there on that there screen was a fire, plus also a toxic event of the worst kind. And we, ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together, were the Hologen Hazmat Emergency Civil Freebooting Company of Exmoor County, Corporate HQ The Nameless Bar, CEO Sally J. Culpepper presiding. And this was the thing that we did better than anyone else in the entire Livable Zone, and therefore anywhere. Sally was straight away talking to Jim Hepzibah and then to Gonzo, making lists and giving orders. She set Flynn the barman to brewing his chews-through steel espresso, and at last even Mrs. Flynn was up off her onboard cushions and moving at flank speed to make provisions, prepare tallies, and take letters for loved ones and estranged ones, and people glimpsed and admired across the floating ash of the nameless bar. We ran to and fro and bumped into one another and swore, mostly because we didn't have anything important to do yet, and there was hubbub and brouhaha until Sally jumped up on the pool table and told us to shut up and get it together. She raised her phone above our heads like the thigh bone of a saint. Sally Culpepper was 6 feet tall, and much of her was leg, and on her right shoulder blade she had an orchid tattoo inked by some kid a quarter inch shy of Michelangelo. She had strawberry lips and creamy skin and freckles across her nose where it had been rebuilt after a bar fight in Lisbon. Gonzo claimed to have slept with her, to have had those legs wrapped around his hips like conjoined Italian calfskin boa constrictors. He said she left him all but dead and grinning like a crescent moon. He said it happened one night after a big job, beer running from the rafters and everyone shiny as an egg yolk with success and soap-scoured skin. He said it was that time when Jim and Sally were trying not to be a thing before they just gave in to the inevitable and got a place together. Every time we all met up, me and Gonzo and Sally and Jim Hepzibah and the others, Gonzo'd throw her a wicked grin and ask her how her other tattoo was. And Sally Culpepper would smile a secret smile, which said she wasn't telling. and maybe he knew what that other tattoo looked like, and maybe he didn't. Jim Hepzibah just pretended he hadn't heard, because Jim loved Gonzo like a brother, and love like that recognizes that your buddy can be an ass and doesn't care. We all loved Sally Culpepper, and she ruled us with her transparent lashes and her milkmaid's face and her slender arms that could drop a punch on you like a steam hammer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.